Radiobiological injury. Cellular amplification. This is cellular damage at the point of the initial radiation interaction, usually involves only very small percentage of the total number of molecules in the cell. At this stage, therefore, any biological consequences of radiation-induced changes may be relatively insignificant. Subsequently, normal cellular metabolic processes may amplify this damage, causing injury to develop from the molecular to the microscopic anatomical level, ultimately resulting in possible gross cellular malfunction. Gross cellular effects of radiation include cellular, molecular, and organic. The phenomenon seen most frequently in growing tissue exposed to radiation is the cessation of cell division. This may be temporary or permanent, depending on the magnitude of the absorbed dose of radiation. Let's discuss the latent period. As you may recall with film screen and computed radiography image processing, the latent image is an image that is not yet visible, but has been recorded on the image receptor. Similarly, we can compare effects of radiation exposure. Latent effects exist following initial radiation exposure and before the first clinically detectable effects occur. An example of a short-term effect of high-dose radiation would be erythema, or reddening of the skin. There is a time lag referred to as the latent period where more serious effects occur. The biological effects of radiation are arbitrarily divided into short-term effects and long-term effects. Short-term effects, sometimes called immediate or early effects of radiation, are visible immediately in minutes, days, or weeks. Long-term effects, sometimes called delayed or late effects of radiation, these are effects which appear years, decades, and sometimes generations later. Let's discuss the determinants of biological effects. The dose effect curve. For any biologically harmful agent, it's useful to graph the dosage administered against the probability of an effect occurring. With radiation, an important question has been the nature and shape of the resulting graph or curve. The image on the left shows a typical sigmoid or threshold dose curve. The point at which the curve intersects the x-axis is the threshold dose, that is, the dose below which there is no detectable effect. On the right, this curve represents linear, non-threshold dose effect relationship in which the curve intersects the abscissa at the origin. According to the non-threshold hypothesis, any dose, no matter how small, is considered to involve some degree of effect or response. There is some evidence that the genetic effects of radiation constitute a non-threshold type of response. One of the underlying assumptions in the establishment of radiation protection guides has been to take the conservative approach and consider that any radiation absorbed will exhibit a non-threshold effect. Under this assumption, some degree of risk is presumed to be present when large populations are exposed even to very small amounts of radiation. It's important to note that controversy surrounds radiation dose effect curves and the presence or lack of a threshold. However, regulatory radiation guides are based on a non-threshold dose effect relationship. Area exposed and shielding of radiosensitive organs and body parts. The extent of the effect is measured by the total radiation received by the patient and primarily depends on the total area exposed. Of equal importance is the nature of the organs and tissue type in the area of the body receiving the exposure. Even partial shielding of a radiosensitive blood-forming organ, such as the spleen and bone marrow, can mitigate the total effect, especially when X-raying children. Let's talk about variations in cell sensitivity. Certain cells are more sensitive to radiation. For example, cells which are rapidly dividing or have potential for rapid division are more sensitive than those which do not divide. And cells which are non-differentiated, for example, primitive or non-specialized, are more sensitive than those which are highly specialized. The factors which generally influence the radiosensitivity of cells and tissues were recognized as early as 1906 by two French scientists. Their findings are expressed in the law of Bourgogneau and Tribondieu, which states, "The radiosensitivity of tissues depends on the number of undifferentiated cells which the tissue contains, the degree of mitotic activity in the tissue, and the length of time the cells of the tissue stay in active proliferation." Radiation-induced mitotic delay in the life cycle of a cell is usually reversible. But based on these factors, it follows that the most sensitive tissues include blood-forming organs, such as the spleen and red bone marrow, gastrointestinal tissue, and the developing embryo or fetus, especially during the first trimester. These will be more radiosensitive than tissues whose cells have a slower renewal rate. Various kinds of cells may be grouped as follows in order of diminishing sensitivity: lymphocytes or white blood cells, erythrocytes or red blood cells, granulocytes or epithelial cells, endothelial cells, connective tissue cells, bone cells, nerve cells, brain cells, and finally muscle cells.